Do you have a metal filling? Have you ever had a root canal? Or maybe even had your wisdom teeth out? With these three questions, today's guest can tell so much about your health. Whether you've got unresolvable gut issues, chronic fatigue, or hidden inflammation, find out why the key to optimizing your health starts in your mouth.
With mercury fillings, there's quite clear that you have a dysbiosis and that you probably have a few fungi in there like candida or mold, which you will also have in your gut system. Everyone has bleeding gums. This is why we floss. This is why we use chemical mouthwashes. But why do you have bleeding gums? Maybe your whole gut system is inflamed. A lot of the dental materials we're using have no function in your body, but can cause toxicity issues, immunological issues, and also can become a micro antenna in your body in this EMF loaded world. We don't need fluoride toothpaste. I consider it toxic and I would never put it into my mouth.
Welcome to the Health Optimization Podcast. I'm Tim Gray, the UK's leading biohacker. This podcast is all about gaining actionable advice from the world's top experts and sharing new breakthroughs in nature, biohacking, technology, and longevity research to help you live longer and happier. Everything I'm going to cover on this podcast are things I've learned from the world's top medical professionals, researchers, scientists, and authors in the health field. However, I am none of those things. I'm just someone with a very keen mind for figuring out how to be as healthy as possible and as young as possible while aging gracefully and learning from the best. My only bias is health. Almost half of the world's population suffer from oral diseases. In a survey of people in the UK, 27% had tooth decay, 53% had bleeding gums, and 90% had at least one filling. But traditional dentists deal with the symptom, not with the cause. When was the last time your dentist asked about your diet, your lifestyle, your gut health, your vitamin D and light exposure, and your sleep? Probably never. But since the health of our mouths is directly linked to our overall health, dentists need to step up. This is where Biological Dentistry 2.0 comes in. Dr. Dominik Nischwitz is a dentist who's deep in biohacking and actually cares about gut health. Yes, I was shocked the first time too. Dr. Dom is the world's leading biological dentist and one of the first ceramic implant specialists and the author of the book, It's All in Your Mouth. Dr. Dom, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Tim.
I wanted to start with explaining how we first met. Because I think this lays the foundation for the whole podcast episode for those listening. Back in 2019, someone introduced me to this dude called Dr. Dominik Nischwitz, who's this world-leading biological dentist, and he came to my conference in September. Anyway, we fist bumped. We didn't really hang out, didn't get a chance. We missed each other while he was in London. But I decided to go and pay a visit with him to go and get my teeth fixed, thinking that that's what I needed. And then ended up realizing that Dr. Dom is actually an all-round biohacker, probably an extreme biohacker at that, that's basically the blueprint for a family man, a businessman, a surgeon, a weightlifter, pretty much everything you can stack together. Now, why I say this is because it gives you the backing for everything we're going to discuss today in terms of, instead of just having one area to focus on for your teeth, it's really your whole lifestyle and your diet and everything around it. So I just wanted to explain that. But then obviously, as we know, big COVID happened and restrictions came about and clinics and summits all stopped working. So we went traveling. And I went with Dom and his family, and we've been to Croatia, and we've traveled a lot. And it's been an incredible journey of where I've actually found a brother from another mother. So Dom, welcome to the show.
Thank you, bro. Love it. The intro is amazing.
It's going to be very weird for us today because we're speaking on a podcast for guys to listen, and we're used to talking, you know, like, I guess like bros. So we're going to be semi-professional today, but guys listening, you're going to have to enjoy the ride because this is what it is. But can you tell everyone a little bit about how oral health is linked to your overall health?
Basically, and from my point of view, the mouth is the entrance to the whole body. You can see it like a tiny microcosm in this bigger ecosystem called the body. Or you could see it like a huge hotel with an entrance hall. and this is your mouth. And it's not just teeth in there that are there for biting hard, tiny things that you can shave off and make nice and clean and drill, fill, and bill. There's also the saliva. There's really the second largest microbiome in your body is in the mouth and the most diversified. So it seems to be quite interesting for the body to keep this sane or sanity, the sanity there. And also, if you see it from an anatomical chart, teeth are not just hard biting things to bite on. They are an extension of your brain. They are the end of that very, very specific nerve called the trigeminal nerve, which is one of 12 cranial nerves that start in the brainstem, but they end on your teeth. So the teeth are, I always say, maybe like an external hard drive for that computer, which is the brain, but an extension. So it's really quite the fascinating little ecosystem in that big one.
What are the impacts or side effects of poor oral health then?
In my opinion, poor oral health equals to poor overall health, because you can, as a biological dentist, at least you would see the mouth a little bit different than a conventional one. And if you see tooth decay, which is a normal dental disease, 90% of all patients out there, actually of all people, have tooth decay. It's the number one chronic disease, or bleeding gums, which is gingivitis in medical terms, or even if it goes a bit further and you have like a chronic inflammation in your jawbone around the teeth, it's called periodontitis. So those are the classical diseases. They translate to the whole body. So if you have any sort of inflammation wherever, it is impacting everything. So, but the mouth is, from a medical point of view, most often, I would say, it's the most underrated part. Feels like it's not even part of the body, especially not for dentists, because we're trained conventionally just to repair things. As you know, drilling, filling, and billing is what they say about dentists, which is not correct. We are craftsmen that repair teeth, but it's more to it. So what we would do is, if there's something to repair, if there's tooth decay, bleeding gum, we can see this as an overall systemic issue, but at one glance in your mouth initially. So it's a very, yeah, like I said, it's the entrance hall to the whole hotel. And if the entrance hall is already shitty, the rest is too.
People say, oh, I've got leaky gut, or I've got issues, or I've got IBS or whatnot. Mm-hmm. And they say health starts in the gut. But in fact, the gut begins with the mouth, right? And the bacteria that we have in our mouth feeds down into our gut all day, every day. So if our mouth is imbalanced and we have chronic inflammation or infections and things, it's always going to be affecting our gut, right?
This is completely correct. At least this is quite logical. If you see that gut system kind of like a tube, then it starts here in your mouth and you know where it ends. And in between is the whole system we're talking about, is usually stomach and further down, like small intestine and large intestine. But yes, just by chewing, and I think we swallow about 1 liter of saliva, including all the bacteria. And if you have oral things happening, not just the disease we just touched on, but also dental repair done, for example, with mercury fillings, there's quite clear that you have a dysbiosis and that you probably have a few fungi in there, like candida or mold, which you will also have in your gut system. And also have to see, you say it's mouth watering when you just think about eating, because before you even start to eat, the digestion starts in the mouth by producing saliva, which contains all the enzymes necessary to break down carbs and fats and proteins. And then obviously you start to chew, which is a part of your digestion. So I think it's really the entrance to your body and to your whole gut system. And leaky gut also starts in the mouth. It's called leaky gum, but anyways.
How can we tell if something in our mouths is actually causing our health issues then?
Yeah, first of all, if there's any problem in your mouth, let's say just a regular dental stuff, you have tooth decay. This is already telling me a story that you might, it's not just about brushing, it goes way beyond it, because I think most of you guys out there are brushing once or twice a day. So why do you still have tooth decay? Why do 90% of all people have it? Number one, ask yourself, or test if you have a vitamin D3 deficiency, because two teeth need, let's say they need nourishment. If they don't get the right minerals and building blocks, they just decay. It's not just the bacteria in your mouth that happens to be there. Anyways, it's more about your lifestyle and nutrition. So first of all, vitamin D3 deficiency, which helps with all, this hormone helps with all, bringing all the minerals into your bones and teeth. But also if you just have bleeding gums, which is also standard. Everyone has bleeding gums. This is why we floss. This is why we use chemical mouthwashes. But why do you have bleeding gums? What is missing here? Why is there an inflammation in your gum tissue? Because you don't have bleeding skin all the time, right? This is outside skin and your gum is outside skin too. Maybe your whole gut system is inflamed and you see it already in your gum tissue. Gingivitis is what the dentist tells you. But the dentist, myself included, is trained to see it locally. Oh, there's a local inflammation. It might be correlated to some sort of dysbiosis or let's say pathogens. That's why maybe taking an oral mouthwash for a couple of weeks, an antibacterial one, will help. But it's just, again, another bandage. Why is this happening? And what can you do? Because I don't even use any mouthwashes or flossing, and I don't have any bleeding gums. So it's possible in nature that we don't have bleeding gums.
We didn't evolve with mouthwash and toothbrushes. Actually, we would use sticks and like branches and stuff like this. And so it's obvious that, I mean, obviously the sugar aspect of this is one part of this, but also the deficiencies in terms of minerals. I mean, obviously when it comes to minerals, if we look at the food these days, they have a lot less nutrients and minerals in them. The soil isn't rotated, so there's a deficiency in minerals in the foods that we're eating. So we're deficient in these things, which is why, you know, using a bit of Celtic sea salt in your water or with your food is actually a good thing, because that gives you 78 to 82 trace elements and minerals. But the point is we're deficient not only from the minerals themselves, we're having too much sugar, we're putting antibacterial mouthwash in our mouths, using toothpaste with fluoride, all these other foods and chemicals with additives from processed foods all day, every day. And then our mouth starts reacting, which is obviously showing something is going on in the gut. And yet the dentists say, oh, you've got a cavity, let's just fill it. That's really leads me on to the next question perfectly, actually, is like, I want you, Dom, to explain exactly how a biological dentist compares to a traditional one.
So let's say a traditional dentist is in university, you will be trained to really repair your teeth. This is the main focus. It's about mainly about pain, managing pain, because tooth pain is insane because it's directly connected to your brain. It's like a neuralgia. We learn a craftsmanship, which is really, really, it's really, really precise. You have to be really good at this because teeth are very, very tiny. So repairing teeth is number one. Then obviously oral hygiene is a big part of it, but it's all about using chemicals and fixing, like it's more like a band-aid because we don't treat the lifestyle. And then maybe number three is aesthetics. We also learn orthodontics, meaning like how can teeth be in line? How is this with spacing? Or maybe use veneers or do something that makes it look amazing, or bleaching or whatever. But that's round about it. We are not trained, like in the whole dental school, which is about 5 years time, you learn really nothing about nutrition besides that you should avoid sugar, which you already touched on. Every dentist will tell you that you don't eat sugar because sugar inherently feeds the, let's say, more pathogenic bacteria and then maybe causes decay. But there's nothing about the overall picture. Is really not connected, even though you learn in university anatomy. We're doctors, we're medical doctors, we're studying medicine. We have anatomy, we have physiology, we have microbiology, we have chemistry, biochemistry, everything. But for example, in school, in the morning, you learn that two different metals in the right next to each other will lead to a battery and will lead to ions moving in your body. But then in the afternoon, when you're clinically working with a patient, you place an amalgam filling right next to a gold filling. And it's like schizophrenic. And this is what you get trained. And in the last semester, I was still wondering. So I was very good with my hands. This was easy for me and I like it. I'm very good with the hands. But something was missing. And this is what led me to this journey to develop a concept that is evolving around that brushing and repairing bit, which is still necessary, unfortunately, but into a melting of that high-tech dentistry with functional medicine and health optimization or biohacking, whatever you want to call it, with the goal of optimal health, which starts in the mouth, and evolving, maybe let's say in a couple of years' time, we maybe don't need to repair anymore. Right now, we still have to repair a lot.
But I want to jump in on this point because we're going to discuss in a minute how the brain is connected to the teeth. But one thing that I remember from my surgery when I had my cavitation, which we'll discuss in a minute, I had my lower intestine twitching as you were cleaning the cavitation in my jaw. And I couldn't say anything at the time, obviously, because I had like loads of apparatus in my mouth and I was high as a kite from all the painkillers. But the descending colon was twitching like crazy, absolutely crazy. And I couldn't understand what was going on. And I'd had digestive issues for years. Anyway, after the surgery, I never had IBS issues ever again. And when I remember telling you, and you said, well, that's because that was on the meridian for your intestine. And I never had IBS from that point again.
And this bit that you just mentioned, this gives me goosebumps every time if I hear that from a patient, because this was the part that was missing for me in university, that I can really help patients heal or getting healthy, because that's not taught in university. It's just about pain management and biting and maybe aesthetics. But this, like besides this really tiny work that all of us dentists love, we all combine with this. So that's why it's also not against traditional dentistry. It's just the next level, future of dentistry is melding it, because everyone likes the craftsmanship. But if then the patient on the next day tells you, oh, my irritable bowel syndrome is gone, my depression is gone, my knee pain is gone, my whatever chronic health issue is 90% better, this is fulfilling. And this is what I want to bring this to. And therefore, obviously, a biological dentist also just uses material that is biomaterial in itself. However, I would say biological dentistry or biodentistry, whatever you want to call it, the next level of dentistry that I'm for is biological dentistry melted with this next level of seeing the whole body and then creating something that helps the patient on his health journey, like really a lot of levels. And therefore, you obviously have to teach them lifestyle and everything.
You mentioned biocompatible materials or biomaterials. What is a biomaterial exactly?
Let's say a biomaterial I would define as something that causes no inflammation in the body or no toxicity, which is just a material that is neutral to the body. Let's say it this way. And unfortunately, a lot of the dental materials we're using, not just the metals, but let's say metals, for example, all of them, including titanium, have no function in your body, but can cause toxicity issues, can cause immunological issues. So basically your body can become allergic to it, and also can become a micro antenna in your body in this EMF loaded world. But there's other materials that we use in root canals, perubalm, colophonium, even silver, like really stuff that is toxic that people know. Maybe it's just tiny bits, but also number three is there is a law, I don't know it in English, but I just translated. Whatever is in the material below 1%, you don't need to mention. Therefore, there are titanium implants, grade 6, which have nickel in it. And nickel is like the number one immediate allergy provoking material. We know that. No one uses it anymore in like jewelry. So this is a little bit flawed, because actually, even though we would love to use materials that are very, very healthy, industry makes it difficult, because below 1% could be a lot for your immune system. Because if you're allergic to something, it is dose independent. Toxicity, yes, I get it. Dose dependent. But as soon as your body is allergic to it, there's a tiny fume, it's a big problem. And you have it ongoingly and you don't even know, because it's in your mouth 24/7.
Well, actually, it's really funny, because I had 7 metal fillings years ago from my mid-20s, which is when things started changing for me. And then I heard about mercury chelation and mercury poisoning and heavy metals and all these things. And I had the tests and showed very high for it. And the funny thing is later on, I heard about a test called the MELISA test, which I know you're very familiar with.
Yes.
And that tests for metal allergies. I showed big reactions to mercury personally. And yet it'd been in my mouth at that point for nearly 10 years. And based on my genetics, which I have, a gene SNP called the MTHFR, which means that I'm downregulated with detoxification and can't methylate properly, methylate to break down mercury and toxins. So not only have I got a metal allergy, my body can't actually excrete them properly. So I ended up becoming like a magnet for metal. And yet you go to a dentist and they say, do you want a filling? Yeah, let's just put some mercury, this stuff that you're really affected by in your mouth and harm your health. And yet they just don't know it.
Number one question is that I always ask, have you ever had any dental repair done? So even on as a keynote on your health optimization summit, I asked three questions in the audience, which I find super fascinating because his audience is like so curated. Those are all people that are already optimizing like crazy. So they know everything already. And then I come in and ask three questions. Number one, have you had any metal in your mouth? Or have you had any metal in your mouth? Stand up, remain standing. And the second question is always, did you have a root canal treatment? Stand up, remain standing. And the third question, which gets almost all of the ones in the audience, is, did they remove your wisdom teeth? Stand up. And then I would say estimation only, but at least 80 to 90% of the audience will stand up in whatever conference I'm asking this. And I find this insane because then if there's a yes to any of these questions, there's something that causes some sort of chronic health issues in your body. You're not fully optimized.
What is the replacement for a metal filling specifically in biological dentistry?
For a tiny filling, you probably can go with a composite, which is, to say it in simple words, is a mixture out of plastic and ceramics, but obviously plastics that are not too harmful. And if you go to a biological dentist, they will make sure that it's, let's say, the least toxic. And in comparison to, let's say, a mercury filling, there's a hundredfold difference. So we have to use some sort of things. So, but as soon as it gets bigger, so let's say half of your crown is destroyed, you go with partial crowns, you go with inlays, you go with full crowns. This is just technical things that your dentist will know. Then you just choose full ceramics, zirconia or lithium disilicate, because those are basically biomaterials, very neutral, and they also stabilize your teeth because you can use bonding to glue it to the tooth. And there's biomimetrical studies showing that your tooth later on will be stable in itself again. So it is possible. So we don't need metals anymore. That's what I want to say. Even for implants.
Yeah, which we're going to get onto ceramic implants in a bit. So that's why metal fillings and root canals are problematic, obviously. But what about wisdom teeth? Why is that a thing?
First of all, if I ask that question, why do I have to ask this question? Like, because 80% in the Western world of all of us have them removed because we have a spacing issue. We are basically grown too narrow in comparison to what we're designed to as humans. Let's say 10,000 years ago, we even had two sets of wisdom teeth, which were easily fitted in our skull. But because of, let's say, agriculture and lifestyle and degeneration, we just got narrow, and we have crowded teeth and everything. So the dentist will recommend, because of orthodontic treatment that also everyone needs because of braces, to take out these wisdom teeth in order to have space for all the other teeth. And some people even need more teeth to be pulled. And the problem here is, again, the dentist knows how to take out the wisdom tooth, but he will only inform you about the procedure, which is there's a surgery, we will use local anesthesia, you will get painkillers and an antibiotic. And you will have massive swollen cheeks and it will hurt a lot and your child should be a week out of school. That's it. And also, usually you take them out between the ages of 14 to 21 when the patient is growing and without any preparation. And then a surgeon is trained to remove these wisdom teeth quite fast because otherwise insurance money doesn't cover it. So that's how I learned it in the beginning. I have to remove four of these impacted wisdom teeth within an hour, which leaves you with a massive surgery, a big trauma, big cut. So big surgery, that was the goal. And as fast as possible. However, this leads to trauma. This leads to unprepared patients with dry sockets, not healing it, secondary healing, and then to something called cavitations in layman's term in the long run that you not even learn in university, which is a chronic jawbone inflammation that happens from an extraction that wasn't where the body wasn't prepared and in hibernation mode and just couldn't heal because it was depleted, or maybe in growth and everything else was needed to build that body, but please not a surgery. So it's a topic that is not known in normal conventional dentistry yet.
Tell us, what is a cavitation then?
A cavitation is the layman's term for a clinical condition better known as NICO, NICO, which stands for neuralgia-inducing cavitational osteonecrosis, or even better, FDOJ, fatty degenerative osteonecrotic jawbone. That's what it is, basically, a mushy, fatty, dead bone tissue in your jawbone, which stems from the removal of teeth. But the teeth that are most often removed are wisdom teeth in the Western world because of the things I just explained. It can happen after every tooth extraction. The problem here is your body was in a depleted state, let's say catabolic or stressed, not prepared, lack of vitamin D3, crucial minerals, crucial protein, all these things that we have in this Western world, and then couldn't heal. And therefore, the tissue developed a cave, and the cave over time becomes ischemic. There's no more oxygen. And then pathogens that anyways live with us, let's say viruses, fungi, parasites, anaerobic bacteria, tend to love it in there because it's kind of like a huge dumping area where there's no metabolism. And then they strive. And Dr. Lechner from Germany, who has done the most research on this topic, even found mercury in there and glyphosates, lots of environmental toxins, and especially patients that fly in from the US, that we have a lot, because in the US there is a huge mold issue. We find mold spores in these cavitations. So the problem here is also, again, it's a chronic silent inflammation in your jawbone. And that means you most of the time don't even feel anything there. But this is a part of your nervous system, which is directly connected to various other things in your body. And you have maybe lots of chronic health issues in your gut or in your joints or somewhere else, which is all easily to be explained in probably your next question. However, first of all, we have to tell patients and even dentists that this one is existing. And this is where we have a lot of, where we fought a lot of fights within the last 10 years, even with universities. But now finally, because of our doing, because we're just clinically doing so many, research is catching on and on and on, and it's becoming a little bit of a thing. So we have professors now in German universities that are finally looking into it and saying, hey, wait a second. What I thought 2 years ago is bullshit is actually quite evident, and we need more research. So it's coming.
If you want to learn how to take control of your health and you're sick of traditional healthcare and temporary fixes, make sure you come to the Health Optimization Summit. You can join other like-minded health enthusiasts and meet the world's leading minds in health, wellness, and science. You can even test out a load of groundbreaking health tech and latest supplements. Get your ticket at healthoptimization.com. Can you have your wisdom teeth taken out safely?
Yes, yes, you can.
Tell us about that.
This is what I was, what I probably worked on the most, because I'm a surgeon, as you know, and I love surgeries, but I'm not the surgeon who loves surgery for doing surgeries. And I realized quite fast with these cavitations that they will get recurrences a lot when I learn from the best. That like 70% of all of them have that again and again and again. And I was wondering, like, why should I do a surgery if it comes back with 70% chance? There's something wrong here. So luckily, because of all my studies when it comes to nutrition and biochemistry and nutrients, I looked into bone healing science and functional medicine and realized quite soon, oh, wow, there is solid science on how to make the whole body anabolic, especially also locally and systemically helping with bone growth, bone formation, tissue formation, as well as teeth. Same thing. And this is why I developed the bone healing protocol more than 10 years ago, which evolved in more like a health matrix protocol. But if you prepare your body before any kind of surgery, it doesn't matter if it's a wisdom tooth surgery or an implant surgery, or let's say a elbow surgery, it doesn't really matter. You just finally, the dentist and the medical doctors should realize there is local healing factors that we usually use if we're good, but we forget systemic healing. Maybe my bodybuilding and training comes into play when it comes to this, because this is science. You have to get that patient in an anabolic environment so that the patient is able to heal. And the good thing is, he will not just heal his local bits, but the whole body will regenerate better. It's like if his house is becoming modernized, starting with his mouth, and he will learn so much more systemically. And this is what I'm, this is probably my main fun pimple. No, this is my main fun part and the most rabbit holes you can go with me when it comes to nutrition. But this is the thing that is missing in dentistry and in medicine conventionally, that people are just, nobody tells you about nutrition, about lifestyle, about how to optimize this body, because this is possible. And this is bodybuilding and more, probably biohacking.
This is the funny thing from my journey here, as you'll remember, and there's a picture of me when we met and how thin I was. And I was, I think it was 59 kilos at the time. And when we met, you were like, oh, he's a biohacker. He's doing everything right. You know, he's ready for surgery. We did a little bit of prep, but anyway, we had the surgery and I didn't heal as well as I should do. And when we looked into it, I was actually catabolic. I was under eating because I had IBS for so many years. So basically I wasn't in a place to rebuild. Although my vitamin D levels were good because I'd been optimizing them, the rest of my body wasn't repairing because I just wasn't eating enough protein or the right nutrients. And I was scared to eat. And so you'll see the before and after of how skinny I really was. And then you said, actually, let's look at this from a full 360, because I thought you were optimized as a biohacker. And that's where I really started to learn how these nutrition pieces all come together within biohacking, and where a lot of people say, oh, you can't eat oats because that's bullshit, or you can't eat this because of the lectins, or you can't eat that because of this. Actually, it's about what your body needs to repair. And I just wasn't given it the right building blocks. So I really think for the listener, like, this is how biological dentistry actually is. It prepares your body, like Dom says, to heal properly. And then the after picture speaks for itself, I think. So we've mentioned it before, but you're one of the first ceramic implant specialists.
Yeah.
Can you explain what this is for the listeners?
So a dental implant, that is if you have lost a tooth and you want to replace, you want a root, a replaced root, a new tooth, so to speak. This is a dental implant. And the gold standard in implantology is using a titanium implant for more than 40 years. Titanium is a metal, as you know, and this works. It's no problem. 99.7% of all dentists will use a titanium implant. So a ceramic implant is the same approach, but it's not titanium. It's a neutral biomaterial made out of zirconium dioxide, which is classified as a ceramic. And for this year first, 2023, it is a biomaterial in medical world. A titanium implant in medical world is a foreign body, which causes an ongoing chronic inflammation in your body, with the innate cytokines being TNF-alpha, interleukin-1 beta, NF-kappa B. Don't want to bore you with that. But a zirconia implant doesn't. It's just neutral. You can finally have a biomaterial in your mouth. And the best thing about it is your tissue loves it. It means when it's integrated, so when your body has perfectly healed it in your bone, the tissue will grow on top of that ceramics. Why is that so beautiful? Because you have a tight junction, meaning no leaky gum, versus if you have it on a titanium implant, there is no growth possible. So your gum will never attach to a metal. It's just not possible. But it attaches to the ceramic. So you will have a closing again. It's an endoprosthesis, which is also an exoprosthesis. And I believe this is the only part in the body where we're doing something like this. Having something inside of the body, like a hip replacement, would be endoprosthesis. It's only inside. But in the mouth, it's inside, but also sticking out. And in the middle, it will be tight. So this is really fascinating that it's working.
If you think about that just for a second, like if we have an implant or something, it goes under the skin, so it stops it getting bacteria in and whatnot. But if you were to have an extension of bone coming out of your arm that had skin heal around it, you would be like, actually, it would get infected quite a lot. And yet our mouth is wet and there's a lot of bacteria in there. So if the gingiva is not attached around the metal properly, you're going to be almost having an open wound consistently, right?
You have an open wound consistently, exactly, if it's not attached. It's the same when you have a gum disease like periodontitis. Then you have an open wound, or gingivitis even, an open wound. And this is why it's even more important in your mouth, because you have so many different species in there. And not all the bacteria living in your mouth are per se negative for your body, but they're supposed to be in your mouth. And they're not supposed to be in your brain. They're not supposed to be in your, let's say, synovial fluid of your hip joint. But how is it even possible that we find Porphyronas gingivalis, which is a typical pathogenic germ in the mouth? How is it possible that we find it in the brain or in the joint? Because of leaky gum. And there's a new study from 2023 showing if that bacteria jumps in there and goes into your brain, it will activate microglia cells to cause a neuroinflammation. So you have an inflammation in your nervous system in your brain caused by bacteria that started in your mouth. So that's how important it is. So having leaky gum is really, really bad for your body and is also the entrance for all sorts of viruses that lurk in your mouth that we learned about the last years. And if that mouth is not tightly closed, they can jump in quite faster. Like, it's really bad.
So we know about teeth infections and having heart issues. I mean, this is common. This is very well known in the medical world, isn't it? How, yeah. In fact, Dr. Harry Adelson, the full body stem cell speaker from our summit, actually had exactly that. He had a tooth infection and it caused him massive heart issues. And that's how he got into this space. So, I mean, that's common, but the less obvious things than heart issues from these teeth, doesn't it make sense that if the bacteria can actually cause heart issues from your tooth, then the bacteria from your teeth could actually cause other things as well, right? And yet the medical system doesn't recognize it. And so why isn't this standard practice, Dom?
To be honest, I don't know, because it's so logical. But it's just, okay, I know why maybe. Because the dental curriculum you're studying is written in 1959. And it was only a little bit rewritten a couple of years ago. The dental one, not the medical one. The medical one gets upgraded quite often. The dental one was like, that means what my dad learned in school was already outdated. And obviously it was outdated when I learned it 25 years later. And for everyone learning it now, is still outdated. So the research is there, science is there, but it's not catching on because we're still living in a area dentistry-wise after World War II, where we just had to repair lots of teeth and there was other problems. But right now, what maybe was the solution 50, 60, 70 years ago could be a strong problem these days because our environment changed so much. Like maybe, let's say in the 50s and 60s, metals in your mouth probably wasn't a problem. Why? There was no EMF. There was no other stressors. There was so much less stress. But now you have a 24/7 stress system in your body designed by dentistry from the last century, mid last century. I think that's why it is, because if you just open PubMed or Google Scholar, you can find anything, everything in a minute. But no one does that, obviously, because it's mostly also industry that is sponsoring things, which is just normal. I don't say it's bad or so, but obviously the industry that wants to promote stuff that works, why should they change something? Never change a running system.
Well, they got shareholders to keep happy. And the funny thing is, those shareholders are the general public, and yet the general public are the people that are ill from it. It's funny you touched on EMF. And I mean, there's actually a study on PubMed, isn't there, about how metal fillings and implants actually act as an antenna for EMF, right?
Well, there are various studies. For example, if you have a phone call with a dental implant or any sort of metal, there is an amplification of that EMFs that come from the cell phone tower 400 to 700 fold. And if you understand that you have that your cell is loaded and basically your body electric, your battery, this will change everything on an ongoing basis. And the other study I think that you're referring to is that if you have a phone call and you have metal mercury fillings in your mouth, the outgassing of this mercury vapor is just higher because of the material oscillating from activation through that electromagnetic waves coming through, which usually go to the cell phone back to the tower. But if there's any sort of metal, it could be a piercing even, it goes to that piercing or to that implant or to that metal filling and causes problems. And there are people that are called electro-hypersensitive. There's a real thing, and they can have all sorts of symptoms and usually get put into like the psychosomatic area because maybe conventional medicine doesn't find anything and a dentist doesn't even look.
Yeah. I mean, it's actually funny about the electro-sensitive people. So our friend and colleague, Mr. Biohacker on Instagram, Joe Cohen, who owns Self Decode, the DNA testing company, he did an experiment because everyone says, turn your Wi-Fi off at night, turn your Wi-Fi off at night. So what he did was he turned all the Wi-Fi off and made sure that he had no EMF at all and slept, measured it, obviously. The next day, he put the Wi-Fi router next to his bed so he would sleep with it next to his head, and it made no difference to him. However, when I turn the Wi-Fi off and I have a remote switch to turn all the plugs off around the house in one go, I sleep much better without EMF. For instance, when I sleep out in the mountains or whatever in a cabin, my best sleep ever, there's no EMF, not a single Wi-Fi, not even phone signal. So it's like, it's, well, basically the correlation is that people that I have met that are high in metals when they have their metal levels tested are usually the electric sensitive ones that can't handle EMF, myself included.
Yes, 100% agreed. And you have to see that you had mercury fillings in your mouth. And I think Joe didn't have that at any point of time. And I'm a dentist. I never had mercury fillings in my mouth. But for the beginning of my career, obviously, because I knew about mercury, I would remove mercury fillings safely for all my patients, like every single day for 2 years. But I forgot one bit. I didn't protect me. So the dentist is actually the one usually mostly intoxicated. Super studies showing that the pituitary gland of dentists are full of mercury, which lead to problems overall. If you understand pituitary gland, what it does in regulating your body, including the hypothalamus, you will understand that if there's any sort of metal in there, that anything in there won't work as well. And then also you maybe know about the Mad Hatter's disease, which is caused by mercury. And yes, also mercury attaches to specific enzymes in the bone, leading in these cavitations more to, let's say, subpar bone metabolism, or even blocks the bone metabolism completely if the osteoblasts are attacked. So yes, definitely, if you had any sort of mercury in your mouth, you have so much higher levels. And the problem also is it's not necessarily showing in chelation tests in your urine or your blood. Sometimes it takes years before it comes out because it's maybe in your bone. And Joe, for example, probably didn't have it. And there's another bit that we can add when it comes to EMF. If you're not having any sort of heavy metals in your body, you need accumulation. So usually if you're living close by a cell phone tower, the problems overall systemically only show after 5+ years. It's a bit of a problem when it comes to research because we just need longer research.
So what can people do to reverse the damage done by mercury, or how can they get the mercury out once they've had the fillings removed?
Yeah, first of all, most importantly is to remove that filling safely. And by safely, I mean lots of different measurements so that you don't inhale more mercury vapor, because drilling out is obviously, if you don't know how to do it, releasing more. But if you have that done properly, you need to find, there's various different routes that you can do, but some sort of heavy metal tests. There's heavy metal tests in the blood. There is chelation tests. Chelation means you use intravenously, you use, let's say, pharmacologicals that help bind these heavy metals and excrete it through the urine, and then you measure. There's also push and catch and stuff like this. There's various different protocols how to get it out. But first of all, measure hair mineral analysis is possible. Problem again is sometimes it takes a couple of measurements and tests and various months before it even shows, because your body tends to compartmentalize heavy metals. So it's possible you're full of mercury, but it never shows in blood, urine, and hair until 6 months or 8 months later, because the body has to get rid of all the other things first. It's really a paradox, but it's crazy how hard it is sometimes to get it out.
I mean, I've done 96 rounds of mercury chelation using alpha lipoic acid and EDTA. I've also used the Quicksilver scientific push catch protocol as well, which is also brilliant. And I've done IV chelation, and I've found this has obviously reduced my levels down to about 15% of what it was when I was mercury toxic. So it does work, but it is a grueling process and it can set you back because it can give you adrenal fatigue and various other things like that. But interesting to hear your take on that. But you mentioned that teeth are connected to your brain. So how exactly is your brain affected when you've had, you know, let's say, traditional dentist work done on your teeth?
Yeah, So I try to make it as simple as possible. So basically, whatever you put into your teeth or on your teeth or in your mouth or in your jawbone will be transported by this nerve called trigeminus, which we show in this B-roll. It's called retrograde axonal transport. And there are great guys from the 1930s, Speransky, he was able to show, I think he used toxic croton oil and put it into tooth cavities from dogs. And within 24 hours, this toxic oil was in the hypothalamus, was in ganglia, was in the pituitary from the teeth because of this axonal transport. And the same thing was done by Störtebeker. And he actually used mercury fillings and realized, okay, mercury will be found within 24 hours in the brain just through that retrograde axonal transport. But there's also chronic silent inflammation. There's an immune system working here. So you have a root canal, for example, or a metal. Then your macrophages, which are it's your innate immune system, is there to basically attack foreign invaders. It's kind of like your soldiers. What they eat, they just eat it and present it. And they build cytokines, which is how they communicate. And these cytokines are called TNF-alpha, interleukin-1 beta. You can measure them, IL-6, NF-kappa-B, the standard ones. And they will be there ongoingly. And they locally lead to tissue inflammation. They lead to activation of the osteoclasts, which are the cells that destroy bone. It's catabolic. But also systemically, if you look into these cytokines, protein catabolism, high cortisol, like lipolysis, like there's so many things. If you just look at these three markers, which happen systemically from ongoing chronic inflammation in your jawbone, chronic inflammation, wherever in your body, you should get rid of, because this is something that activates not just your fight and flight, but also cytokines, your immune system, your neurotransmitters. So it's affecting everything, plus the retrograde axonal transports that we just talked about. So really, it's a bomb. It's a time bomb in your mouth.
So you ask your patients about their vitamin D3 levels when they come to see you.
Always.
Why? And what other aspects of nutrition do you look for?
Yeah, we actually asked the patients 4 weeks prior for their vitamin D3 when they sent their initial inquiry. Why? Let's say it's a super simple, quick glance, because vitamin D3 is a key hormone in your body, which helps with bone metabolism, but actually overall immune system and also reproductive health, all the other hormones. So it's a key player for everything. And if it's low, which it is for almost everyone out there who is not supplementing or in sunlight every day, you will have a subpar healing or not even any bone or teeth health. Therefore, I want to have a vitamin D3 level. And we will also remeasure it when you come in, and it should be above the norm. So we're shooting for optimal ranges, which is above 60 nanogram, or let's say nanomole would be above 150 nanomole per liter. But this is only one little bit, because you have to see nutrients work in synergy, like a soccer team. There's maybe David Beckham who plays wing, but there's also a goalkeeper and the whole team, and there's also the trainer. Whereas medication works with blocking something or flooding something. So I look into the synergy of everything, which is in the food design. I'm looking into macronutrients first, which is optimizing your nutrition. Number one is protein, because we need a lot of amino acids for your immune system, for your bone building, for your neurotransmitters, for your hormones. This is first. And then fine tuning with micronutrients. And maybe vitamin D3 is David Beckham, let's say it this way. But we need vitamin K2. We need magnesium. We need boron. We need zinc. We need activated B vitamins. We need methylation, like you just said, because all the chronic health issues for patients that had dental health issues, they all can methylate, even though they have maybe don't have the methylation SNP for it. They just deplete it because they had to methylate their whole life, and they're just not there anymore. So therefore, it's a common health issue, which I've just included into all the teachings about bone healing and overall health matrix. So omega-3 fatty acids, there's so many things, the basics.
Yeah, the basics that most people don't get right.
I know, man.
Like the water, the minerals, the macronutrients, i.e., you know, being vegan and not eating enough protein,
yes,
or having a less than perfect protein that hasn't got a full range of the amino acids, you know, not having the right fatty fish oils or from fish itself.
Or like you said, just the wrong lifestyle. They're just maybe a biohacker and think if they do a ketogenic diet and fast and do only one meal a day, they're enough. No, they're not. They're just ruining their health. So
yeah, I can attest to that one. I can attest to that one.
We can all, but it's a learning curve.
So I just want to, we're going to have a quick fire round before we wrap up, Dom. And these are all questions that people have asked me to ask you. So first of all,
love it.
Should we use fluoride toothpaste?
No. We don't need fluoride toothpaste. Fluoride obviously is stuff that we learn in university, helps with your tooth enamel, strengthens your teeth, but it's also an extremely strong disinfectant. And there's so many various health issues regarding fluoride that I consider it toxic and I would never put it into my mouth because there's also better alternatives. So go fluoride free for sure.
I mean, we don't have a fluoride deficiency, right? And why are we supplementing with fluoride when vitamin D and vitamin K, and actually on the vitamin D and vitamin K thing, I just want to say for the listener, once heard this analogy, which has really stuck with me. So vitamin D moves calcium around the body. Okay. So that means, you know, potentially into bones. Vitamin K tells it where to go. So vitamin D moves calcium around. Vitamin K tells it where to go. So therefore back into the bone, back into the teeth or whatever. But there is one other thing that I just want to touch on, is like hydroxyapatite, which is something that's seeming to pop up everywhere now when it comes to oral health. Now, I believe it's a biological dentist thing, but is that a good replacement for fluoride, do you think?
Yeah, hydroxyapatite is basically the stuff that is built, that is a part of your enamel. So if I would build a toothpaste, I would consider putting hydroxyapatite in it. But again, your body is able to build it itself, and your teeth are naturally hard as granite if they're healthy because of the stuff you feed your body. So it's coming through the blood from the inside feeding your tooth, and from the outside through the saliva, which replenishes your tooth all day long. And therefore, like you said, D3 moves calcium, K2 tells it where to go, and magnesium is kind of like the co-driver that you need for it. And a quick glance in your body, or in your mouth, if you have, let's say, more plaque or tartar buildup, typical sign for calcium being at the wrong spot, K2 deficiency. So just look at these things and you can move around your calcium. And you also don't want to have it hang around in your artery. We'd rather have it into your bones and teeth because that's the storage unit for minerals in your body.
Okay. What's your daily dental hygiene routine like? Do you floss? Do you use mouthwash? Do you rinse? Do you tongue scrape? What do you do?
No. it's a bit controversial always because I'm living in a bubble. I curated this for years and I obviously think that everyone does the same as I do. I know it's not the case. So for most of the guys out there listening for the first time, I would still consider brushing your teeth very important just to clean it, even though we might can do it differently. I personally brush my teeth once a day. You have to understand, I don't have any tooth decay. I don't have no dental repair done. I have no bleeding gums, nothing. And let's say my nutrition and my lifestyle is kind of supportive to what the oral health needs. So not a lot of deficiencies, probably surplus. So I can go with it. And my goal for all my patients is to move into this direction. But I understand that we're designed to use chemicals and flossing and mouthwash as a band-aid to what is usually happening, which is tooth decay, bleeding gums, gingivitis, periodontitis, and lots of dental repairs. So you might need to work your way to it. But I use a toothpaste, which is non-toxic, fluoride-free. I have a lot of designs for it. And it would be a supplement that supports my teeth and cleans them at the same time. I don't use floss because I don't need to. My teeth are perfectly together. There's no dental repair. There's the gum in between and it's tight. I would consider using a floss if I had something stuck, but I would rather go with like a stick or something. But this is when I would use it. And I don't use any chemical mouthwashes. Maybe for patients for, let's say, a week or two, maybe if it's extreme and we have to, let's say, wipe out a couple of the extreme pathogenic ones, but usually we go chemical mouthwash free and use oil pulling instead, usually coconut oil pulling, which is an Ayurvedic strategy. Coconut oil specifically because it's containing lauric acid, and it's also, it's quite antibacterial, antiviral, soothing to the gums, soothing to the teeth. You cannot do anything wrong besides just not doing it. And I use something called tongue scraping, which a lot of patients do, but specifically use a copper tongue scraper. Copper, again, Ayurvedic strategy. Copper is antibacterial metal, and tongue scraping is a, it's an investment of 5 to 10 seconds a day where you just basically scrape the ground of your tongue, the bottom of your tongue, and get off these debris, which over time you don't have anymore, because I don't, because I do it so for such a long time, I don't have it. There is no more fur on my tongue, but if you start it, you will really scratch off stuff. And again, the key is doing it. It's inconsistency. You have to make a habit out of it. So if you use coconut oil pulling once a week, it's probably not enough. I would consider doing this every single day and finding a structure where you just do it. I personally would do it while I make my breakfast or my meal prep for the day, because I have no extra time needed. Some patients use it while driving to work, because you have to have it at least 5 minutes into your mouth and swish it around. You can even do 15 minutes, especially right now when wintertime is coming and there's more and more bacteria and viruses in your mouth. It helps so much. If you feel that, you know, that feeling, like that scratchy throat, these like brittle lips and everything, start coconut oil pulling and take a little bit of vitamin C and vitamin D3, K2, and you're probably good to go just by doing these tiny little strategies in wintertime.
So my next question was, what's one thing the listener can do to start doing today to improve their oral health right away? And now, obviously, tongue scraping and coconut oil pulling are two good ones, but is there anything else you'd suggest?
I would say consider testing, measuring your vitamin D3, or at least supplementing it if you haven't done it. I would measure it and supplement right after. We could start it straight away if you see us, because we will do a vitamin D3 chairside. So within 10 minutes, we know, oh, it's too low. But just quite simple, if you haven't supplemented with vitamin D3 within the last 3 months, you probably depleted, because the half-life of vitamin D3 of the storage form is only 15 days. So this is why also when you come back from summer vacation, let's say in September, most people get sick mid-October, early November, because their vitamin D3 is just too low, especially obviously in countries where we have no sun. It's above the 32nd parallel. So let's say above Rome or above Los Angeles, you just have not enough vitamin D3 production through sunlight naturally in the winter month. Below, it's no problem if you go out in the sunlight, but I have enough patients coming from all over the world that where you think they have a high vitamin D3, but they live in Dubai and they're inside all day long.
And they're covered in clothes. They're inside wearing clothes in fake lit offices and not getting enough sun. So evolutionary speaking, we would have been okay because we weren't fully clothed and in air-conditioned offices, right?
Exactly. And we would go out into the sun and build our own sunscreen factor, which is brown skin. But imagine a person with darker skin. There are studies showing that they need 6 to 10 times more sunlight. So imagine someone with a darker heritage living in Finland now. So he probably needs 20 times more and will be depleted. This is also, it's quite clear. And yeah, we're designed to run around half naked at the equator.
What an interesting chat. I mean, we could go on forever and drill into many, no pun intended, drill into many different areas of biological dentistry and answer so many questions. So I'm really looking forward to this podcast coming out with, you know, the questions. And, you know, we'll look at the questions and we'll answer what people have. But thank you very much, Dom, for coming on the show with me today. I really appreciate it.
Dude, that's my pleasure. Always, man, always. Love it that they're finally there.
Massive thank you to my guest, Dr. Dominik Nischwitz. Learn more about Dom at dnaesthetics.de, or you can check him out on Instagram at drdome1. You've been listening to the Health Optimization Podcast. I'm Tim Gray. Comment and leave a thumbs up if you enjoyed it, and subscribe to my channel to see more. You can also find the podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and all the usual places you like to listen. Check out the show description for extra information and links. See you next time, and remember, spread the health. The information contained in this podcast is provided for informational purposes and is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. Information found or received through the podcast should not be used in place of a consultation or advice from a healthcare provider. If you suspect you have a medical problem or should you have any healthcare-related questions, please promptly call or see your healthcare provider. This podcast, including host Tim Gray and the producers, disclaim responsibility for any possible adverse effects from the use of information contained herein. Opinions of guests are their own, and this podcast does not endorse or accept responsibility for statements made by guests. This podcast does not make any representations or warranties about guest qualifications or credibility. This podcast may contain paid endorsements and advertisements for products or services. Before using any products referenced on the podcast, consult with your healthcare provider, carefully read all labels, and heed all directions and cautions that accompany the products. Individuals on this podcast may have a direct or indirect financial interest in products or services referred to herein. This podcast is owned by Health Optimization Limited.